Welcome to our Radiographics podcast. I'm Jeff Klein, editor of Radiographics, and today I'm pleased to have with us the author of our paper, which is entitled Magnetic Resonance Enterography in Inflammatory Bowel Disease with Endoscopic Correlation, which appears in the current January 2017 issue of the journal. I'm pleased to welcome one of the authors of this paper, Dr. Pankaj Kaushal from the Department of Radiology at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital, who's here to talk with us about the paper today. Dr. Kaushal, your paper is a beautiful review of the complementary utilities of both endoscopy and magnetic resonance enterography in the evaluation of patients with ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. While it is recognized that both the fiber optic and capsule endoscopy provides direct visualization of mucosal abnormalities, and that fiber optic endoscopy obviously allows for tissue sampling, and in Crohn's patients with fibrostenotic disease, obviously offers the possibility of stricture dilatation, imaging provides additional information in patients with inflammatory bowel disease. Can you begin by describing how you, at your institution, perform your magnetic resonance enterography studies in your patients with inflammatory bowel disease?
Sure. First of all, thank you very much for having me today. And I'd like to start by reiterating what you said, that MRE and endoscopy are complementary modalities in evaluating patients with IBD. Put very simply, MRE involves a combination of T1-weighted pre- and post-contrast imaging, T2-weighted imaging, and diffusion-weighted imaging in evaluating the inflammatory features that we see in IBD patients, as well as the extraintestinal features, after patients have undergone a bowel preparation that involves large amount of oral contrast. At our institution, patients drink about 1,450 milliliters of volumen, which is a barium sulfate suspension. They do this by drinking a bottle of volumen every 15 minutes prior to the exam. So that takes about 45 minutes of preparation. And finally, they drink 500 cc's of water just prior to the exam image acquisition. Volumen not only it acts as a contrast agent, but it also acts as an osmotic agent, meaning it draws in more water into the bowel lumen, so that further helps with the distension. And the point of topping it off with water is, it's very difficult to achieve adequate distension of the duodenum. So water helps with that aspect. After that, the patient is ready, and we give 0.5 milligram glucagon intramuscularly to minimize bowel peristalsis, and then we start the image acquisition. We start by obtaining T2-weighted axial and coronal plane rare images. This is followed by axial and coronal T2-weighted FISP images, T1-weighted images in axial plane, and then finally we do diffusion-weighted imaging. So that's the first half of the exam. Then before the second half of the exam, which involves contrast administration, we give additional 0.5 milligram dose of glucagon intramuscularly. And then we obtain the T1 weighted vibe images, which are fat saturated pre and post contrast. And it's a dynamic phase exam, so we obtain arterial phase, portal venous phase, and delayed imaging in axial and coronal planes. So the whole thing takes about 45 minutes or so.
45 minutes, that's what I was gonna guess. Well, that's terrific. So turning to the paper now, we've chosen figure 4, which I think is a really nice example of the use of MRE with a nice correlation with colonoscopy in a 15-year-old patient with Crohn's disease. Can you take us through the images in this particular case?
Absolutely. So as you mentioned, these images are obtained from a 15-year-old girl was having intermittent right lower quadrant pain, and it's a good example of active inflammatory subtype of Crohn's disease. We have coronal T2-weighted rare images, the 4A images that, and then we have the arterial and portal venous phase T1-weighted vibe images post-contrast. And we also have the endoscopic correlate. 4A is the T2-weighted rare image in which we see thickened terminal ileum, and there is slightly increased T2-weighted signal intensity within the ileal wall. that is due to the edema that we see from inflammation. In addition, as you may notice, there's a lot of fat around the terminal ileum. So the terminal ileal loop is sort of separated from the remaining bowel loops, another feature that we see in Crohn's disease patients. On the figure 4B and 4C are the arterial and portal venous face images. These demonstrate progressive transmural enhancement of the terminal ileum, which we previously saw was circumferentially thickened. In addition, the arrowhead is on engorged fascia recta, which is one of the classic features we see in Crohn's disease patient and, you know, has been classically described as the comb sign. 4B image shows some prominent small bowel mesenteric lymph nodes. So again, all of those features corroborate actin inflammation. And the axial image that we have, 4D, that shows, you know, transmural enhancement, hyper-enhancement, I should say, of the terminal ileum, the lymphadenopathy, and the comb sign again. And finally, figure 4E is the endoscopic correlate, which shows linear ulcerations in the terminal ileum, which go along with the active inflammation we were seeing in the MRE images.
That's terrific. So moving on, we know that about a quarter of patients with Crohn's disease end up having long-standing fibrostenotic changes, usually within 10 to 20 years of diagnosis. In figure 7 in the paper, you show an MRE finding in such a case. Can you take us through the endoscopic and MR images in figure 7?
Absolutely. So this case shows a 41-year-old female who had undergone prior ileocolectomy. So she has ileocolonic anastomosis in the right upper quadrant. So at the site of the anastomosis, the first image is a T2-weighted rare image. We are seeing thickening of the neo-terminal ileum wall. But in contrast to the images we saw in the prior case, there is no increase in T2-weighted signal within the wall. So it's very black. In the next image, next two images, 7B and C, these are T1-weighted vibe images in arterial and portal venous phases. We are seeing some enhancement of the mucosa in these images, but it's not progressive transmural enhancement that we were seeing before. This is probably the trickiest part in interpreting the images, because you always see some degree of mucosal enhancement. Right. And you know, that should not be confused with active inflammation.
Sure.
In contrast to the prior images, again, there is no vasa recta engorgement. We don't see any lymphadenopathy. All of those features go against active inflammation.
Yeah.
So this is just a dysregulation of normal healing response, which results in fibrosis, and there's no superimposed inflammatory changes here.
Great.
And the endoscopic correlate that we're seeing is, you're seeing smooth luminal narrowing in this region. There is no ulceration that we saw previously. There's no hyperemia of the mucosa here as well. So again, this is a good case of fibrostenotic disease. In this particular case, they could not pass the scope beyond this area of stricture.
I see. Well, that's terrific. Now, turning to ulcerative colitis, which is the other inflammatory bowel disease, it's recognized that there are early mucosal findings in UC, such as edema and granularity, that we're not going to be able to depict on magnetic resonance enterography, but that the hyperemia and the progressive edema will result in thickening of the wall and increased signal in the submucosa on the T2-weighted imaging. In the subacute and chronic phase of the disease, there are some characteristic findings that can be seen on MRE.
Yeah.
And figure 13, I think, shows us some of these findings. Can you take us through figure 13, the case, and just sort of illustrate some of the findings that are demonstrated here?
Sure. This case is of a 64-year-old woman who had long-standing ulcerative colitis. We have a T2-weighted rare image in axial plane. We are seeing thickening of the rectal wall. there is slightly increased signal intensity within the rectal wall. This is because of the submucosal fat deposition and not due to the inflammatory infiltrate we see in active disease or active inflammation. In addition, there is luminal narrowing as well of the rectum, which is seen because of muscularis mucosa hypertrophy. And around the rectum, we are seeing perirectal fat deposition, which is another feature that we see in longstanding ulcerative colitis. As a result of that, you can see there's widening of the presacral space as well. So all of those features are classically seen in longstanding ulcerative colitis patients without, you know, superimposed active inflammation that we tends to have. Hyperenhancement of mucosa and edema within the wall and ulcerations.
Great. Well, in closing, I'd like to thank Dr. Kaushal for joining us today to discuss this paper, which appears again in the current January 2017 issue of Radiographics. Thanks very
much. Thank you again for having me today. And on behalf of the rest of the authors, Drs. Levy, Samwar, and Charbadi, you know, we would like to thank Radiographics staff throughout this process and also, again, inviting me here today.
Well, thanks for your contributions. Yep. Appreciate it. Mm-hmm.